Good morning, friends. It is good to be with you. Happy Easter. Oh, thank you for that warm response. I appreciate that. My name is Richard Burkle, and I'm the minister of music here. And this is my wife, Megan. And we are glad that you are here this morning. There's a tradition on Easter that the leader would say, Christ is risen, and the congregation would respond, He is risen indeed. So can we try that real quick? Christ is risen. You did that perfect. I love it. If you're a visitor with us this morning, or if this is not your regular place of worship, we would love to meet you on the other side of the divider over here after the service. There's a connect card. We want to know just a little bit more about you and how we can stay in contact with you. And Megan is here to tell you some additional ways that you can stay contacted over the next couple of weeks.
Hi, everyone. Happy Easter. I wanted to tell you about two exciting opportunities to plug into our First Baptist family. The first one is actually next weekend on Saturday, April 6th at 8 a.m. We will arrive at Church Street United Methodist just across Henley Street to join churches from all over the city in the great day of service. Now, I love when service projects are easily arranged for me, don't you? Yeah? Okay. So check out the options and sign up by scanning the QR code in your bulletin. And I hope that you will join us as together we serve our neighbors in need and show love for our community. Now, ladies, what is God calling you to? Maybe you just heard His calling and you're discerning your next steps. Maybe you've been living out that calling for a while now, but the fire you once had for it has dimmed. Maybe you feel you've missed that calling altogether, but I promise you it's not too late. I want every woman in here, young or old, to join us in our sanctuary on Saturday, April 27th for our Ready to Rise Women's Conference. I have had the pleasure of hearing our speaker, Jo Saxton, and she will lead us in a transformative experience as we learn to own our voice, gather our community, and step into our influence empowered by the mighty Spirit of God. Registration details can be found on the insert in your bulletin, and I hope to see you there. Thank you.
All right, friends, we've got an opportunity for some hands-on worship this morning, so listen up, here are your instructions. You see the cross is here in front of us, and it is a wonderful and beautiful tradition. I see you've got flowers in your hands. If you don't, there are flowers back here. Gary's got some more. So it's a tradition on Easter that we flower the cross, and obviously the symbol of that is celebrating the new life that we have through the resurrected Jesus. We take this ugly, old, busted cross, the symbol of death and suffering, and we flower it with new life and we make it beauty. So as we sing this first song of Praise the Name, I invite you as we stand just to come on up and put your flowers in the cross. Let's stand and worship God together.
I cast my mind on Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid Him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all death, where is your sting? in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will
Our scripture reading this morning is Matthew 28, 1 through 7. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began.
Been
harvest rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made a new now, life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new now, life begins with you.
Sing this out.
Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free.
Please pray with me. Loving God, you are the creator of the universe. You created everything we can see and everything we can't see. And sometimes we don't know what to do with that. You're not a distant God. You are a God who cares intimately about every life on this planet. Both the people in this room and the people that live across the world that we will never meet. And sometimes it's just hard for us to comprehend. And yet, you care about us so much that 2,000 years ago, you assumed human form and you came and lived among us. And you allowed yourself to be vulnerable. And you allowed us to hurt you, both emotionally and physically. And yet, because you're so powerful, you overcame that. And today we celebrate that resurrection, both for what it meant 2,000 years ago and for what it can mean in our lives today. When you were here among us, you tried to simplify it for us, and you said, it all boils down to this: just love the Lord your God and love others. And yet we still try to complicate that. We oftentimes spend so much time worrying about trying to be right or trying to control others or trying to do things that just have nothing to do with what you were trying to tell us. So we ask today, in this worship service and as we leave this place, that in all that we say and do, we would spend less time worrying about ourselves and worrying more about loving you and loving others. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand and sing together. Our next song is Blessed Assurance, and you'll recognize this text. It's been a part of our singing history for many, many years. It's the expression of love of God's people for the Lord.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of
is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His
Let's give God thanks for the resurrection. It's so wonderful to be with you on this Resurrection Sunday. We've been moving through the season of Lent, thinking about the way in which Christ calls us to follow in His footsteps. And for the last couple of weeks, we have talked about how it means to follow His words, to do what He says, to follow His way, learning the way that He walked out His life, and then to follow His will. And in many ways, the last couple of weeks have been difficult to hear because we know that His way can be hard and the road is narrow. But today I want to talk to you about the wonder of following Him and the wonder especially of a resurrected life. When we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, it is the wonder of wonders. It's the wonder that is beyond any wonder that we might have in life. You know, all of us have times of wonder. We have these moments that kind of take our breath away, kind of blow our minds. Maybe for you, you can remember a moment of wonder at a great sporting event. Or maybe it was when you walked out for a starry night. Maybe you had a moment of wonder when you held a grandchild for the first time. But think of the moment when you trusted Jesus. What a moment that was when you first put your trust in Him. And you knew that you had salvation in his name and that everything was going to be different because he had given you his Holy Spirit. Today, we sit in awe of the wonder of Christ coming back from the grave, but in many ways, it was the culmination of a life of wonders that Jesus walked out on the earth. When Peter was giving his defense in Acts chapter 2 of who Jesus Christ was, he said that Jesus of Nazareth was a man who was accredited by God with miracles, signs, and wonders. Jesus worked miracles wherever he went. He would place his hands on those who were blind and they could see. He would tell the man who was crippled, "Take up your mat and walk." There were signs that accompanied him. He would speak of the ways in which he was going to change everything, like the sign of the fig tree that was withered, saying that ultimately Israel was not the vine that was going to carry the life that he wanted to bring into the world. And he was a man of wonders. He even raised Lazarus from the dead. Before he did that, he spoke to Martha, Lazarus's sister, and he said that he was going to rise again, Lazarus would. And Martha said, "Well, I know that one day it's going to happen. One day there'll be the resurrection from the grave." And Jesus said, "No." He said, "Look at me. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" he asked her. He was asking, "Do you really believe that I am the life today? Do you really believe that the resurrection power that is coming to you is going to change everything? Not only the gift of being with God eternally, but do you really want to live today?" 2,000 years later, it is the same question before us as we consider the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? Do you believe he's not only a great moral teacher, a friend of sinners, a friend of the marginalized, a man of great miracles? Do you believe more than just the historical facts of him dying on the cross and then rising from the grave? Do you believe he is the resurrection and the life? Because for many people, there is a lot of deadness within their souls. For many, they're walking around, they have biological life, and yet there is a spiritual deadness. There's no life. There's no passion, no purpose. Wouldn't you agree that many people have lost their sense of wonder? They've lost even an edge of wonder when it comes to considering Jesus rising from the grave. For many people, life is monotonous, just a single line of walking through each day. We get up and we do what we need to do and go to work and pay some bills, come home, walk the dog, go to bed, repeat the next day. And where is the wonder? If you're honest, you might confess today, "I have lost the wonder." Well, I'm here to proclaim to you today that wonder is found in Jesus Christ. And the wonder of him being raised from the grave can put wonder in your heart. I want to describe this today in three simple movements. The wonder of his death on the cross, the wonder of his resurrection, and the wonder of lives that continue to be changed through him. Now, the first is the wonder of Jesus' death on the cross. All Jesus did was preach love and grace. All that he did was call people to the truth. But they nailed him to the cross like a common criminal. They condemned him to death in a mock trial. They put a crown of thorns on his head, nails in his hands. They lifted him up on the cross while his mother was watching. And he could have ended it at any time. At any time, Jesus said, "I could have called down 10,000 angels," and yet he would not do that. He stayed there for you and for me. What a wonder, his death on the cross. Now, there were all kinds of supernatural events that marked this moment when he breathed his last for the forgiveness of our sins. The Bible says that from noon until 3 p.m, darkness came over the land. About 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" The first sign here was darkness over the land for 3 hours. Now, the word means that the sun utterly failed. It was as if the light had turned off. Some have wondered if this was an eclipse, some sort of natural way of describing this, and yet Matthew is suggesting a supernatural darkness that came over the land. It was symbolic of all the pain, all the suffering, all of the misery that we put one another through, the way that we judge one another, our anger. He is taking all of it on his shoulders, and it's like darkness was descending on him as well as all of us as he's giving his life on the cross. He cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He felt utterly forsaken by his heavenly Father. Now, they thought that he was calling out to Elijah, Eli, Eli. But Jesus had already said in some of his teaching that Elijah had come. It was believed that Elijah would come before the Messiah, and yet Jesus identified John the Baptist, who was the prophet who came in the spirit of Elijah. No one was coming to save Jesus in this moment. And the people, it's this spectacle that is all around him. They're wondering, is he going to be saved? We're going to watch for a few more minutes. And so they went, they got this sponge with some sour wine and gave it to him, maybe to prolong his life just a little bit longer. Let's just watch. Let's just see if Elijah comes. Can you imagine this spectacle? Like a circus. Looking at him up on the cross. All the brutality, all of the suffering of this world represented in this moment. And here was Jesus absorbing it all. The malice and the mockery and the indifference, all of it heaped on his shoulders. The Bible says that when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. He gave everything. There was nothing left to give. His life was poured out as an offering for the sins of the world. What a wonder. Every sin dealt with. The greatest expression of love the world had ever seen. And after he gave up his spirit, the Bible says, another wonder happened. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook. The rocks split and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. Let's think about these elements. There was the curtain. The curtain was the veil that was very thick between the holy place and the holy of holies in the temple. It was beautiful, ornate, blue and red and all sorts of different types of yarn and embroidery. It was that which separated the people from the very presence of God. For it was believed that that was where God's presence dwelt. And not everyone could go into the Holy of Holies. In fact, only the high priest once a year would go in on the Day of Atonement, go through that curtain, and sprinkle blood on the altar for the forgiveness of sins for the people. And so the veil was torn from top to bottom. An image of how this curtain was completely broken open, a symbol of how now everyone had access to forgiveness. Everyone had access to the living God. People could go directly to God for forgiveness and for help. That is the meaning of the curtain. It was a wonder. Then there was an earthquake. Now, in the Bible, an earthquake was a symbol of God's judgment or of God's deliverance, of God's power. The rocks split open, the tombs broke open. God was literally rocking Jerusalem at this time. And some may say, well, in this moment, Matthew's kind of gone off the rails. I mean, was this just sort of his version of CGI, exaggeration, over the top for what was happening. But listen, throughout the Gospel of Matthew, he tells things in a very matter-of-fact way. He shares the details of all that was happening in the life of Jesus. And when we come to this, we can't just hit the pause button and say, well, now he's talking in apocalyptic language. It's just sort of over the top for effect. No, he is describing what is happening. Remember, Matthew was a tax collector. Tax collectors know how to keep the books. They know how to describe things in detail. Matthew is recording the facts, and he says, look, there were signs and wonders. There were amazing things happening, including an earthquake. Then we see how the graves were opened. The tomb was split open, and the people came out, those who were holy, who had come before. The Bible says, after the resurrection, they went into the city, and people would see them. Can you imagine the dinner parties after that? These people that had come back from the grave, what a wonder. A foretaste of his own resurrection that was to come. All these signs point to who Jesus is, the wonders that accompanied what he was doing on the cross. He was taking the sins of the world upon himself. Do you believe it? Do you believe not just in the historical fact of him dying on the cross, but have you had a personal and profound experience of what it is to be forgiven of your sins? Because it's not just one that is sufficient. Yes, it's important to believe in the actuality of what happened to Jesus on the cross and the reason why he was dying, and yet it is a whole other thing to experience it for yourself, to have love come down and fill you with hope when you know that you've been forgiven. If you've never done that or experienced the forgiveness of sins that leads to a lightness of heart and a wonder of walking through life, then you can say today very simply, God, I know you died for me. I know I need forgiveness. Would you please help me to experience it? Would you share your life with me? There was the wonder of his death. But then there was the wonder of Jesus coming back from the grave. He came back to life. On the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and another Mary, there were a lot of Marys in the Gospels, by the way, they came to the tomb, and the Bible says they had just come to look at it. They were in incredible grief, overwhelmed, and they just wanted to be near to Jesus. Have you ever done that before? Gone to a graveside, gone to a tomb, a gravestone, because you just wanted to be closer to your loved one. Maybe you knew they were in a better place, and yet you just wanted to be close to them. They come to the tomb just to look at it, with no expectation that Jesus was going to rise from the dead. But here's what the scripture says. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, his clothes white as snow, and the guards were so afraid of him, they shook and became like dead men. Now notice that the women were still standing while all the men fell down. They were the first to the tomb, the first witnesses of the resurrection, and all the men, all of these brave, strong soldiers fall down, becoming like dead men. This is a symbol of how Jesus' power is greater than any military power, any economic power, any force that this world might have. These simple women of faith are standing and hearing the good news of Jesus Christ while everyone else is cowering back in fear. And then there was an angel. Another wonder. The appearance like lightning. Clothes as white as snow sitting on the stone. Yeah, I wonder, what's the symbolism of sitting on that stone? It's kind of an odd thing, right? But I think it was kind of a victorious move. Like, look what I did, you know? Look what's happened. The stone has been rolled away. And there is this victory posture of sitting on that tomb slab like it had no more power. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, grave, where is your sting? Christ conquering sin and death and despair. What a wonder. Death defeated. Light overcoming darkness and grace greater than all of our sin. The wonder of a resurrection. But apart from the wonder of the cross and the wonder of his resurrection, I don't believe there's any greater wonder than the way that Jesus is still changing lives 2,000 years later. He's still changing lives. We see all the miracles, the darkness, the earthquakes, the angels, but just think how even today, 2 millennia later, Jesus is still changing lives. Still people are coming to him. Still people are receiving salvation in his name. And so this is the wonder of changed lives. It began there at the tomb. People were being changed by the power of God. Rome's toughest soldiers saw the power. It says in Matthew 27, when the centurion and those who were with him were guarding Jesus and they saw the earthquake and all that happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Now that was as much a political statement as anything, because Caesar was known as the Son of God. Every centurion, Rome's greatest soldiers, declared their allegiance and that Caesar himself was the Son of God. And yet, that centurion proclaims what the world would come to know. That beginning wonder pointing to the greatest wonder of who Jesus is. The women were changed. They went from sadness to joy, from doubt to faith. God took these women who in that day weren't even trustworthy in a court of law and made them the first witnesses to the resurrection. They were changed. The angel said to them, "Go quickly, tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I've told you." It's like his job was done. Angels being the messengers of the Lord. "I've told you this. Now go and tell others." And so the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. I believe that with some of the greatest wonders of life, there's that mixture of both being afraid as well as full of joy. For those that have raised a child or been parents, you might know of the fear you might have as a parent, but also the great joy that accompanies it, the wonder of that child growing up. So here we see they are transformed in the power of the resurrection. The cross and the resurrection aren't just historical facts. They declare that Christ gives us a power that is available to you and to me. Your life can be changed. My life can be changed. Romans says the same power that raised Jesus from the grave now lives in you. The moment that you accepted Christ as Savior, the moment you come to Him, God plants a power in you that is greater than any challenge, any darkness, any mountain you might ever face. More than an historical fact, the Bible declares that when you accept Him as Savior, God puts in you a power that will raise you from the dead, make you alive in your sins being defeated, forgiving all of it, correcting the course of your life, disarming the power of the enemy, breaking open the gates of hell. Everything can change as God shares with you His everlasting power in life. It's the wonder of the resurrection. Isn't it amazing that God's still changing lives 2,000 years later? I think of Charles Finney, who was the Billy Graham of the 19th century. His testimony is that when he accepted Jesus Christ as Savior, he felt a joy like he had never experienced before. And he began to tell everyone about the power that is found in Jesus Christ. He became a force in the anti-slavery movement in England and other social changes, including voting for women. He was on fire for the Lord in the power of the resurrection. Mother Teresa was so convinced that Jesus had come back from the grave, she dedicated her life to caring for children. She picked up 70,000 children over the course of her ministry. Bill Wallace of Knoxville, for whom Wallace Memorial is named, was so convinced that Jesus rose from the grave that he gave up a lucrative medical career. He dedicated his life to go and be a medical missionary. He inspired a generation to give their lives to serve. These aren't just in the past. I know a man named Kenny who gave his life to Christ after stiff-arming God for years and years and years. And when he unexpectedly encountered the living Christ, he was radically changed. I know a man named Ray who kept God at arm's length for decades and decades, but his wife had been praying for him for years and years, and when he gave his life to Christ, there was incredible rejoicing, and he was changed. He became a great pillar of the faith. I think of a woman named Sherry I used to work with who was very timid, very introverted, and she didn't think she could be a very good youth worker. And yet God, in the power of the Holy Spirit, helped her to become one of the best youth workers I've ever been around. You see, there's the truth of the resurrection, and then there's the experience of the power of the resurrection. We need both. Not just to know that you have been forgiven of your sins and that there is eternal life in Jesus Christ, but to allow God to come in that resurrection power and take your ordinary life and make you into a wonder at what the power of God can do. So here's the question. Have you lost your wonder? Have you stopped believing what the power of God can do in your life? Have there been some things that you would have just scrawled over those things? Impossible. The problem is too big. The challenge is too great. I'm never going to change. This person is never going to overcome the difficulty that they're facing. Have you ever just written over something impossible? Have you forgotten the wonder? The wonder of what God can do. I heard about a minister who was in Italy one time, and he was touring various churches, and he happened to wander into the graveyard of that little local church. And he saw a grave of a man who had been buried centuries before. And it was clear by the markings on that tombstone that this man was an unbeliever, and he was actually against Jesus, but he was a little afraid of it at the same time, because what he had done before he died was he had a slab made, and he gave instructions that his loved ones were to put that slab over his grave, a heavy slab of granite, just in case there was the resurrection from the dead. He said, I don't want to be resurrected from the grave. There were things on his grave that said, I don't believe it. I don't want to be resurrected just in case it's true. But this minister walked into the graveyard and he saw that place, and evidently when this man was buried, an acorn fell into the grave. So 100 years later, this minister saw this beautiful, towering oak tree, and he looked at it and he saw how that slab had been split to make way for that new life. And this was his reflection. He said, if an acorn, which has the power of biological life in it, can split a slab of that magnitude, what can the acorn of God's resurrection power do in a person's life? Think of all the things that you think are just immovable, the immovable slabs of life. Maybe it's bitterness for you. Maybe you've had an insecurity your whole life, and you think, I'm never going to overcome this. Your fears, your self-doubts. The good news of Easter is that those things can be split. Those tombs can be opened. The more you know him, the more that you grow in the power of the resurrection, the more you spend time with him and seek him and read his word, the more you pray, the more it stirs up this resurrection power that is within you through the Holy Spirit. That is what he offers you today. It is an invitation to wonder. What can God do in your life? What's your prayer? What's your big prayer, God? Here's what I'm asking you to do. What a wonder that he died for us on the cross, that he rose from the grave, and that he's still changing lives. Let's pray. Oh God, in the power of your Holy Spirit, I pray that you will speak, and that God, we might hear that personal word that we need to hear on this Easter morning. Because I know in this room there are lots of challenges and many mountains, God, that just seem immovable. And yet, God, you offer us the power of your resurrection. The same Spirit that raised you from the grave is now available to us. It is planted within us, God. So may we not neglect that power, God. May we not be those who lose our wonder in life, but that we may lean into it, Lord, and believe ever more fully on this Easter morning that you are alive and that your power is in us. Oh God, be glorified as we worship you. And we pray, oh Lord, that you might give us again that sense of wonder at who you are and what you continue to do. In Christ we pray. Amen. I invite you today to give your life to Jesus Christ. Maybe today you weren't expecting to make a decision. Maybe you weren't thinking that God was going to do anything special in your life. Maybe you just thought, I'm going to go celebrate Easter and that's enough. Well, what if the Spirit is speaking to you something today? What if God is saying, it is time. It is time to commit your life to me. What if today the Lord was leading you to make a decision like a line to cross? It's time to step over that line in discipleship and to learn what it is to follow in his footsteps, not only in his words and in his will and in his way, but also in the wonder of that resurrected life. That is offered to you today. Maybe right where you are, you need to bow your head as we're singing together and ask the Spirit to speak and say, Lord, look at my heart. Is there any place that's become bitter? Any place that needs change? God, would you come in by your power and change me even today? We're going to stand and we're going to sing together. And as we do that, I'll be at the front. If you want to come and pray or you have a decision, let's stand.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and
We owe everything to Jesus Christ. And the cross that was a symbol of death and despair has become a picture of hope and of new life. That is what we celebrate today. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
We are grateful that we've had an opportunity to worship together. And we're thankful that you've joined us today. We've got quite a few guests that are in the room, some from out of town. It's always wonderful to gather with believers and remember the grace that comes to us through Jesus Christ. And remember the power of the resurrection. He's still changing lives, and he can change your life in whatever way that you're seeking him. One way to put your faith into action is by joining us for the day of service next week. Megan's already mentioned this. I'm going to be serving by a little project where we're building a handicap ramp for someone at their home. There are lots of ways to serve, and there are a few projects that don't have anybody signed up yet, so please check that out this Saturday. Again, a great way to put your faith into action and to let people know about the love of God that is in you. And then I do invite all the women in our congregation to come and to take part in the Joe Saxton event. We're just about a month away from that, but we expect it's going to be a wonderful time of encouragement together. I'm beginning a new sermon series next week called Rise, and it has to do with the way that in the book of Acts, all the culture and community was impacted by the power of the gospel as it moved out into the world. And so the Ready to Rise conferences, especially for women, love for you to check that out, and that we might continue to grow in our faith and knowledge of Jesus Christ. Hey, let's take a hand together. I'm going to offer a word of benediction. Love for you to stick around for the time of Bible study immediately following. This is a picture of the church. No, like a good picture, I mean, like surrounding the cross. You all were thinking like a picture of the confusion of the church. Okay. All right. So we remember that God has done everything for us, and we are forgiven of our sins, and that together we have hope in Christ, the resurrected life, the power of God in us. And so let's bow and hear this word of benediction. Go placidly amid the noise and the haste, and remember what peace there can be found in silence. Give freely, laugh easily, love deeply, and preach boldly. And above all, don't be afraid, for the Lord your God goes with you wherever you go. And now may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the presence and power of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you now and forevermore. And all of God's people said, Amen. Amen.